This is the only measurement of progress in an agile environment. When you see your burndown charts and your developers say, yes, it's done, what does it mean? No, nothing. So sometimes your burndown charts, they're, I don't know, 10, 20, 0%, right? In the end, you don't know what the developer really means when you put this task on done. And that's the problem. So what we want is to overcome this 90% of done syndrome, right? So that we can really say, yes, it's done, it's live, it is something we have in a production environment. We want, this is just a note, right? In every project, a software delivery pipeline should have a delivery pipeline. So as a principle, a good practice to follow, every developer have a clear understanding of what do I have to do until certain things, yeah, and get my vision from certain things from developing into integration, over testing, staging, packaging, all those things until it's done, right? So everybody have a common understanding of that. This is really, really important. And for continuous delivery, we aiming for automated, right? In the first place, it doesn't really matter if it's manual or not. But when you really aim for continuous delivery, it should be automated. So how does our pipeline look like? I mentioned already, from the idea we had until production, but in between, this pipeline are stages, right? So, and the first stages, they aim for a rapid feedback. That means those stages give the developer, anyhow, a feedback, like a unit test, right? That the code he's developing or the changes made do what he expected to do, right? And later on, we have more tests and more things we want to go through until we have the confidence that what we're doing is exactly what the customer needs, and no surprises, we'll have it on production systems. And those tests are having increased resources with hardware, increased resources with execution times, and increased resources as well with many people with certain skills. And as later we go through the pipeline, the stages will be more and more production-like. Of course, it's the best when the developer already works on a production environment. We will see that when we are helping VHDL. But in a normal case, you might not have a cluster of server next to your opportunity, right? That might not happen. So this will be our example pipeline for the speech, which when we go through this pipeline, what will happen is a developer developed a change, right? Change is mostly a requirement, right? So we develop something, a code. Code can also mean a configuration change, it's also code, right? So we check it in our version control system. We have the first code of the game, which are usually the unit test. After the unit test, we packing something. We want to store things on an artifact repository. We don't want to build them from the whole pipeline over and over again, so it's a waste of time. So we deploy our binary, our artifact, which we store before, later on the test environment. We run functional tests like backwards tests, regression tests. Then we might deploy it on staging system, which runs the acceptance test. And then we have the last, is the most important part. It is an environment which describes the similarity between a pre-production and a production. It is, in the best case, it's a mirror, right? So, but sometimes, of course, that's the amount of money you might spend on a production system is really expensive. Well, and then you explain to your client, okay, we need a mirror of that, a complete mirror. It might not gonna happen. So, but it should be similar to the production system. And in the end stages, we might run performance tests, security tests, non-functional requirements, right? So, multi-folder wrote a very good phrase. So he said, continuous delivery is software development principle, where you build software in such a way that software can be, this is very important, can be released to production at any time. So we have two things inside. The first is can, the second is any time. In my career, what I've heard a lot is that people interchange the word continuous deployment with continuous delivery. So what's the difference? The difference is the last step. The last step is when you put something from your pre-production into production, right? That's the last step. In continuous deployment, companies doing like Facebook, Flickr, all those unicorn web companies, they deploy continuous deployment. They bring a change until production automated, right? In continuous delivery, we cut this a bit and say the last step in the pipeline is a business decision. So the business says when we want to bring something live. When the business says we deliver every 2 weeks a new change, it's their decision. We don't mind. It's not a technical decision. We could. But they say, okay, 2 weeks, we're fine for it. But what we aim for is that every change we produce ends up on our pre-production system. And we can bring it at any time live. That means when our business guy is saying, well, or heard maybe, well, you developed a quite cool feature. Can we bring this actually now live, now in this moment? And you say, yes, we can. Right? So the ingredients for continuous delivery is continuous integration, a version control, which usually means software configuration management, and I would like to add automated, repeatable, and reliable deployment. That's very important as well. But first things first, I spoke about that we have to have a clear understanding of our pipeline. A way of doing that is the lean value stream mapping, and it comes from the lean guys. They said, well, to have an idea, the simplest thing that you might can do is look on paper and write down all the steps you have between your vision in your head until something goes out to production, right? Note this, and then in the end it gives you certain tools actually. Right, this is a tool, it's not pen and paper. It gives you 2 times, an execution time of a stage, of a step, and an elapsed time. Elapsed time means when we have a time here for a handover, for example. Let's say we have departments, right? A QA department for testing. All right, we bring them something, and then we have to wait maybe until we get a feedback from them. We will talk about this later, why we should renew ourselves, but they're existing, I know they exist. And it can mean as well when we have a test server and we have only one, we might cannot test in a parallel way, right? So maybe we have a queue up front and need to wait until the tests are executed. And all those things, they capture together as the lead time. The lead time, again, is from the idea in your head until something is released. And we aim for reducing the lead time. So we will enlighten parts of the pipeline. Right? So the first part is the commit stage. This is the developer code-focused part. We will speak about, now here in this part we see that it's code focused. We aim for rapid feedback. Rapid feedback means whatever I want to know, I have to know it in 10 minutes, 10 minutes max. The developers are waiting because, how I say, when we speak about a change, they have to see if what they're doing is correct. At least, let's say correct in a way that it integrates perfectly, and it's the behavior from a source code is this what I developed. Not from the user perspective, from the development perspective, right? Only the developer. We run as well normally here, I would say unit test, the static analysis, dependency analysis, and the packaging before we store this into the repository file. We will speak about, I mentioned about the feedback loop as well, right? We will speak about here a bit slightly, right? 2 sentences about test-driven development, mutating testing. What does it mean to write a bit of clean code? Mainline development, feature focus, and branch by abstraction. I know our time is very limited, so we have to hustle. But what we aim for is this is the question we want to know. If this, what we developed, the change we did, is from the development perspective, is this is really what we want, right? The behavior. Unit tests. Okay, hands up, who's writing unit tests? Okay, keep your hands up when you write the test before the code. Alright. Okay, a unit test, right? A unit test is a test to prove that the developer did something correct, right? And in a test-driven development, they aim for that you write first a test, see a test fails because we have no implementation yet, write some code, run the test, it should go green, and then you can start refactoring, right? This is a brief description of test-driven development. But unit test is not QA. Why is it not QA? Think about you go with your source code to QA, and you give them a bunch of methods, classes, and say, here, unit test. And then you go. And then they're standing there, okay, what does this method actually do? You don't know. They don't know. You know. You should know, right? But they don't know. So they need time, again, to understand what you did in source code. Break this. Unit test is development side. Developers have to write unit tests. It is as well an executable documentation. When you see a unit test from a month ago and they're still executing, you see what kind of execution results they have, right? So even if you forgot what you implement a very, I don't know, complex algorithm, right? the result speaks about it. So you see what you did anyhow. And this is only for test-driven development. You have a fearless refactoring, because they call it going on the green path. You try never to break a test. That means when you do refactoring, you never break a test, even when you refactor. Unit tests are good, no worries. Unit tests are fine. But the problem here is, unit tests say nothing about how good is the quality of my test. It says nothing about it. And especially when I hear code coverage, right? It's a metric. It is not a quality indicator, it's a metric. That means it only, this metric, right, code coverage, only means that this certain lines of code are covered from a test. It doesn't say anything about if the test is good. So that means no test, not tested. Yes test, it might be good tested. Here comes mutation testing in. Who have heard mutation testing? Anyone? One. All right, but mutation testing is doing, it can give you an indication about how good are my unit tests, right, from a project. So what it's doing is, when we have our source code here, and our original test suite here, this is the output, it takes the source code and makes mutants out of it. So that means, it's change operators, right? When we have a decrease operator, those plus, minus, minus, it changes into plus, plus. It changes argument chains, right? From the first argument, it takes the second, and the second, the first. It renames variables. It changes operators and it all, right? All those stuff. It changes those. And when your test still pass, when the test seek of the mutants still pass, that means your tests don't cover all possibilities, right? So in the end, both test suits are compared, and when your results from the mutants are the same, then your test doesn't cover everything. When you kill all mutants, then you say, yes, I covered all possibilities we might have in a mutation way, right? So all the things might go wrong are tested. It can give you a quality indication of how good are my tests. It's consuming, so my idea is, or my tip is, don't let it run forever in your project. When you see, or when people are new to unit tests, bring maybe those things in, let it run for a couple of months, and then see if the results are getting better. If they're getting better, kick that out. That's resource. You need a lot of resources for running.
John, is there any automation tools to run?
Yes, this is R. Actually, this is a tool, Cream is the name. It's .NET, okay. .NET tool. Another one would be NinjaTools from the Teenage Mutant Ninja Tools. NinjaTools is not a tool. But it's .NET side. I don't know about the Java side. Okay, read this carefully. All that. A developer asks the developer, right? All that. Well, Mark and Steve, which are actually not longer in the company anymore, brought the routine back when Daniel, who left last month, I was trying to find a workaround for Julia's input processing code. Actually, she's in our department now. To work around for Julia's processing code, right? I don't think it's used anymore, I'm not sure, but actually she don't have any time to document it. But at least it works, isn't it? So when you stumble into those projects, who have ever mentioned those situations? All right, that's what I expect, a lot of arms going out, right? Otherwise you would all write the perfect code. So what's the problem with that? It's an anti-pattern. It's the big ball of mud. Because what we have is usually struggled wire, duct-taped, sloppy developed, deadline code, which are don't have time for quality aspects anymore, kicked out. And you stumble into those projects. And you have to make a change on those projects. You sit there and try to understand what the previous developer did. And you try to analyze as well the impact of what you are doing. And this is so hard because you can't see it. That means we need architecture to support continuous changes. We aim for continuous delivery, right? We need architecture to support it. And there's so many of it. The gang of four patterns. Have anybody heard the gang of four patterns, the design patterns? The behavior, social, and Wendy? What's Wendy? Vincent? And creation, yes. One example. Another example is the solid patterns, right? The solid principles, the grass over P principles. We have for UI GUI development, right? We have the MVP, MVC, MVV, whatever, right? There's so many dependency injection. Modulating software and libraries, right? There's so many ways. You don't have to create a monolithic source code. You don't have to. So skip that. Another anti-pattern that I have seen in my career are feature branches. Why are we doing feature branches? We're doing continuous delivery. Continuous delivery doesn't mean setting up a Jenkins. We have continuous delivery. Yay. No, it's not. A feature branch, the problem is that we increase the scope of lines, when lines of code related application. We increase the scope for lines of code. So we don't want since we are doing continuous evaluation, we don't want that we wait until a feature is complete when it takes more than one day to integrate it. We want to have it integrated daily, at least daily, once daily to the mainline. That means mainline, right? This is the main branch, right? So we spoke about scopes. Try to find a bug, right? You develop a feature branch, your feature branch, you merge it back, and then a bug appears in your unit test, or unit test doesn't satisfy you anymore, right? Try to find a bug. It's a difference when I integrate once a day and I wrote 200 lines of code, rather than 1,000 lines of code in one week, right? So the whole scope is different. The identification of bugs is simpler, it's easier, because the lines of code are minimized. So we have a delayed integration. We don't we might have a more effort of merging, because again, lines of code, but it's just more. We increase the test effort. Let's say we're running regression tests. They might take longer, right? So why not scope it in a smaller chunks? And yeah, the speed time for regression tests and integration tests. Right? So how do we do it? We do integrations, right? Continuous integrations. We minimize the integration chunks. A small piece of code, right? Every day, at least every day. That doesn't mean that you cannot, I don't know, commit something to mainline 5 times a day, right? It depends on the developer, but at least once a day. So we decrease the risk, so the quality is higher. And it's easier to identify defects, because again, the scope of source compliance is smaller. And it improves heavily morale, because you get things anyhow into a state where the developer knows, yes, I integrated, my unit tests are passing well here. So you're going home with the satisfaction feeling, right? It's just better than running things a long time on something. The problem here is, let's say a feature can be not finished in one day. That happens. So a feature cannot be finished in one day. This is only a perfect world, but we don't live in a perfect world. So what are we doing with this hard implemented thing when we want to integrate once a day? We hide it behind a feature toggle, right? We hide it behind a feature toggle. And the simplest feature toggle is a simple conditional statement, an if, right? An if, a simple if. If I want now that this feature is visible, yes or no? And when it's not done yet, we hide it. So that means when we ship something, it is not in the shipment yet. But it doesn't mean that your unit test you cannot run against already. You can. Because the source code is not documented, right? It's not that there are two slashes in the front. No. The source code is existing. It's just not triggered, it's just not executed. Another problem we usually deal with is legacy code, right? And we have frameworks, libraries, and then anywhere it comes to the system up to either change a license model, go to another library provider, or change frameworks to another framework, right? How are we dealing with those stuff? So let's say we have a component, whatever it is, library, frameworks, whatever, right? And we have consumers, right? Can mean different parts of our application. Doesn't mean or monolithic thing. Different parts of the application consume those things. So how we change this when we want to reach again continuous integration? It is not that easy, but it's possible because we bring in an abstraction layer, right? A wrapper in front to wrap the calls to go in. That means we can slightly and slowly start delegating the calls we do to the library through the abstraction layer. We do this maybe in the first day for the first consumer. So then we have an abstraction layer, his calls go through the abstraction layer to the component. The other one still goes straight to the component. And the next days, we bring this completely, all calls going through the abstraction layer to the old component still. At the same time, we use that opportunity to bring in unit tests in the abstraction layer. If we have expected results from the component and the calls we expect, right? And then we make a cutoff. Then when all the parts going through the abstraction layer, it doesn't mean what's in the back, because they don't see it. The consumer don't see it anymore, right? Actually, if you pick it out or not, it's your decision. Maybe you want to have a feature where you say, well, we support this version, but as well like this version, right? Let's go to the next stage, which is the acceptance stage. In the acceptance stage, what we care is quality, only quality. And we want to know if this is really a candidate for production. If all requirements the user says, right, if all the things are satisfied, that's what we want to find out here. And what we will look, because we have limited time, only is early stage testing for high-loaded tests. And the board of communication, what does it mean? And the feedback loop we will talk about is the one from usually the acceptance test, if this is from the user perspective, the real behaving we expect, right? And if this is satisfied. Usually acceptances, everybody knows. Who knows acceptances? A lot of arms, come on guys. All right, and I wrote executable specification. An executable specification of an acceptance test is an executable specification of the behavior of a system under test, right? So we want that behaving, the user be walking, is this what we expected. And then on stage test, the problem is when you have to deal with non-functional requirement, like performance, it's a big deal to know it is. And we have those tests usually in the end of our pipeline, because those tests are expensive. We need dedicated knowledge, we need isolated servers, we need to make sure that everything runs well, right? We may want to test the whole cluster, right? We cannot do this, and we want still to aim to get anyhow a feedback earlier. So how we can achieve that? We can anyhow get a trend, right? So the trend is very easy to set up. Actually, tools like JMeter helps you to set up those trends very easily. So what you can do is, you will see if an execution of your latest change will decrease or increase your performance. So you can at least say, it increases the performance, right? You don't know how big the increasing is yet, because it's not on the performance test side yet. But you know you have a trend already. Okay, it goes up, yeah, we are faster now. Or on the other side, it goes slower, right? Those tests usually gives you the answer of a sustainable capacity and throughput. That means if you have to scale up your server parts, right, or not. This test only answers, are you getting slower, faster? Simple as that. Another problem we usually face is, we spoke about continuous, we spoke about reliable and repeatable deployments. But what does it mean? Only ops people usually know how to set up their server parks and the clusters and whatever they have, right? We don't know. And that's a big problem. Because we would like to develop in a close production-like environment, right? This is our aim, it's our goal. You would have as well an updated software version. So, but of course, we don't want to break the versions from the operating people. We're going to use different versions. Right? You want to have a self-sufficient environment which we can run isolated to something. So we don't have to deal with setting up and then bringing down. Virtual machine is a good example. A virtual machine to start takes time. You want to not have that time. It's just too slow. And then try to run six virtual machines at the same time. Maybe, I don't know, if you have strong machines, you might can do that. Otherwise, so, and maybe we want to create our own small deployments and see if we can really deploy everything and run small acceptances as well as developers. And we want to have a fast setup for new team members to bring them in a development stream, right? We don't want to deal, set them up, and say, okay, you have to install this. No, give them something, and they run AB. And the ops people, they have totally other concerns. The ops people usually, they're caring about hardware resources. Is our server parts enough? Are they configured? All the stuff, right? Maybe they have software standards we don't consider. For example, they might think every single thing we do have to have a logger, but are they telling you that? Maybe not. They want to have automation. They don't want to install five times Tomcat, right? So when it's once, why is it not enough? And of course, they especially want to have stable software. So you don't want to have any more surprise in a production-like environment or in the production, right? So all those things should be tested, well tested, and we should be confident enough before we hand over something to operation. Usually those departments are separated. And the culture of breaking this wall of communication goes into DevOps, so we touched it as well slightly. What comes in here is Docker. Docker is the lowest common factor to describe the different concerns of both departments. What you can do is the operating department, you sit together, like development operating, sitting together for a couple of hours and defining a Docker file which describes how they're working and what they're doing, which version they're using, and so on and so on. This file is readable code. It's not a virtual machine which you can not store on a version control system. It's text. You can put this under version control. It's possible. So you bring those teams together, and then later on you ship out through the pipeline only containers, defined containers, from the first stage, which is test, from the first integration stage, right, through test, through staging, until the production-like environment. You're only dealing with containers. And Docker is awesome, but this goes into DevOps talks. So attend DevOps talks if you would like to know more about Docker. The last stage of our pipeline is the delivery stage. This is the stage when we are confident enough we won't have any surprises in a production environment. So we clear it works, it is work like expected, it has the behavior we need. So then we deploy it to a pre-production server, and then we run, since it's the similarity of our production system, we run the high-load test, right? The usually non-functional requirements test, like performance test, security test, maintainability test, usability test, all of stuff, right? We run it here. Because that might need a specific skill set of people, so it's expensive, so we want to run them last. So it's only delivery focused. Here's the part where we're producing documentation. Whoever produces documentation here and maybe violate the 10 minutes rule, kick out the documentation. We don't need it here. It's good to have, maybe you have it once, that's fine. Here's the one where we deliver documentation, right? Here's the part. Before, if you need it, if necessary, yes. If not, kick it out, it's a waste of time. Here we run the end-to-end test. End-to-end tests are run by the QA department. This is the one why we need the QA department. Even acceptance test. In an agile team, everybody is responsible for quality. There's no QA department where you throw something over the wall and let them dealing with all the quality aspects. No, it's not. Everybody is responsible for quality. That means even you as developer can write acceptance tests. Whoever has the best understanding of what the requirement says can write an acceptance test. And those steps, only trigger when we are done for releasing, right? And it does not start, nothing starts here before we don't have the confidence that there will be no surprises in production. The worst that happens is that your software crashes in production, right? We speak here about the last feedback loop from your idea in your head until it's released, right? And we will touch iterative delivery and evaluate learning. That doesn't mean. When we speak about agile, all those people working in iterative cycles, right? Who's not working in iterative cycles? Everybody works in iterative cycles, right? But what does it mean? In an agile way, the goal is to release after each iteration and continuous delivery all the time at best, right? Think about continuous deployment. We're releasing when the change goes through the whole pipeline. And we're confident it's released. So it's end up on the user's plate. Right? This is what we want. So sometimes you can see as an anti-pattern, it is not getting released by ever. There's a something like that. When a requirement is we want to cut something, right? We have to think about this is the hard part actually. What's the simplest thing we can develop and ship out to a customer? A customer will never tell you, that's a lie. A customer usually don't tell you what they really want. And they're changing their mind, usually quite often as well. But they will always tell you what they don't like. This is what they always tell you. So when you deliver them something, and you know already, well, this is not the best approach, they will tell you, what did you develop? You have to make this and this and this changes. I don't like it. They will tell you that because they're paying you, right? Because this is the running method. So when the requirement is we wanna cut something, the simplest thing is not building a Swiss Army knife. The simplest thing is to build a plastic knife, maybe. And when the customers or the users say, well, I'm confident, I'm satisfied already with the plastic knife, there it's good to go. It's the simplest thing, it's cheap at release, good to go. If they say, well, I would have an upgrade, I would have a case around, and maybe a bottle opener, and then the next iteration maybe a saw, and then in the end we have a leather mat, right? That's fine, we can do it. But the problem here is, it's the big scope thinking up front. And it actually increases with the experience of developers. When you develop a long time, over 10 years or something, you're thinking too complex of it. Right? You miss the simple solution you can maybe implement. And that's a tricky thing. And as well as when you're sizing your backlog, we heard yesterday only 20% bringing the business values. Right? So it's highly important for product owner and developers to figure out this 20%, what brings the most value to the customer. And then to developers as well, how can we implement this 20% in the simplest way when they want to have a configuration? We might don't need XML configuration. We might only need, a single file lined with the configuration parameters. You never know what's going on until it's sold or used. And this is so true. With all those data we spoke about, with the changes we made, the thing that we want to know is if it's used, if the client really uses it, right? But if the customer is satisfied, all those things we only get when we show them something. This is so important to show them something. Right? And we want to have it as often as we can show them something. So when we aim for a releasing every day or twice a day, we can bring them something and we analyze those data. We validate the learning, right? So we keep the releases and figuring out, do they like it? If the clicking is anyhow going wrong, or the interview, we bring in surveys. We're asking them directly, right? If this is really what they want. How's the time actually? Right. Okay, to summarize a little bit. Continuous delivery, to summarize, continuous delivery aims to reduce the cost, time, and the risk of delivering incremental changes to users. We spoke about incremental changes. We have seen we minimize the risk with integration and smaller chunks. We decrease the time we need. When we identify bugs in early stages, we know that already because we integrate smaller chunks. As well, when we try to run performance tests earlier than trend, we have an earlier feedback. We can react earlier. And it's the cost as well, because when we, how I said in the beginning, right, continuous delivery aims for automation. That means when we don't need people going manually through protocols anymore, everything was automated, with Docker you can achieve those things. And everything is defined under version control. This is great. And this will save you a lot of money and headache. So this is what we want to do. So it means we deliver cheaper, faster, and with a higher quality. Wait, this one. Thanks. Okay, we have the time, right? Yes, okay, questions? Yeah.
Just want to ask, what is, if the bad thing happen after a when we do continuous delivery for the application, I think if we use container or platform as a service, it easily come back to the previous person. But how about the data? Can
data
you tell your best practice?
Okay, data use. Earlier I say the pre-production system, right, should be a similarity. So that means for data as well. So we want to deal with the data we use in a reproduction system. If you might have problems, for example, can you give a good example? When you want to deal with real data they might use, you cannot run a test sometimes similarity at the same time, or maybe even iteratively time after time. Let's say you have a login, right? Your login name is Dave. The first test will succeed, right? You run the second test with Dave, when you your captain test, right? And then it will say, oh, Dave exists, so test failed. So what does it mean? You are responsible, or actually the acceptance tests are responsible for cleaning up the data and using this data, right? It means when we have here the example of a login, you are similar to the real production data you use, right? Similar. It's not the same. You cannot, because you automate things, right? And so what you're normally doing is you're adding at the end a generic number, right? Which is anyhow unique bit. So Dave 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then next case you use Dave again plus anyhow a random number again and so on. So that means you clean up your mess in your test. And this well means in a good environment, but it's how say we try to reduce the lead time, right? Sometimes people will say that an acceptance test shall cover from the first until the last step, right? Mm-hmm. So that means when you want to check anyhow a card system, right? So you might create the login, right? You log in, you put in something in your card and you check out those four steps. So people will say, and I agree slightly, that you don't have to log in all the time. This is a waste of time. Except the acceptance tests, they need a long time to run normally, right? So you kick those out. But what kind of data do you actually need?
Data in production data.
Yeah.
We need to clean up the vector or you have another...
you try to mock it, right? When you... There are two examples. The first thing is you mock it. If you don't know anything about data yet, you mock it. So you with your best leadings as a developer. Usually, when a system is running already, you get those data, right? So that means you can even take a stub of data and use the reproduction data, but still you have to think about it. When you're running tests, if you violate those data, right, then you have the complete test. So I would recommend a stub, but because then you really see how data goes, right? Where the problems are in the database as well. So when you're running acceptance tests and you try to cover all the possibilities of variables they might put in a stream, right? Mm-hmm. hard to achieve. So, but when you have start already with the millions lines of entries in the table, you can use this. You have to, I would as well recommend, since you can run those 100,000 lines of logins, right? Mm. You should run always the most things on the edges, right? So something like defect testing, test the boundaries. This is how I would do. Yes, answering your question here?
This in testing environment, right?
Yeah.
But how is the problems in production environment?
With the data.
With the data.
In the production and production system. Can you give me an example?
Currently the application version is 1.0. After we do some continuous delivery, we deploy the newest version 1.1.
Yeah.
But after 1 or 2 days running, there are some issue, some problem.
Okay.
And some transaction already logged to the application.
Yeah.
And we have to, we have a decision. We need to go back to version 1.0. But the data is already
From the 1.1.
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's tricky. This is what I can tell you. There are things. So first is what I would recommend is a business toggle, right? So it's, we spoke about feature toggles. I can show the slide, but it's not explaining much, I guess. It's a business toggles. When you want to have in operating already, right? When you want changes of the software. So you might have a feature which you want to hide when the access of people is too high. So you cannot handle the load anymore. With those stuff. Another thing is we talk about databases. Databases, what you all normally aim is not, you don't make alter tables, right? Especially in continuous delivery and continuous deployment. Carefully think about that. Altering means a lot of time of execution first, and second, you sort it yourself to a specific version. What you should do is add columns. Add columns to tables that you have still both columns. So in a web, all right. In a very worst case, you have columns for all your versions. When the data is really totally different, right? Mm-hmm. To support different versions. And with a business toggle, you can decide when you're going to which version, right? Of this column. That's a split possible. So yesterday we heard this for product ownership. When he sits together and define the backlog, he needs also different hats, right? Because you don't know all the aspects. It's the same here. So when you have functional teams, that means you have zeros. Right? So you have your business analysts, you have developers, your testers. Try to cut it up. If you have a chance, I mean it's structured to the organization sometimes. If you have a chance, you can cut this. Do it. Set those people together. A development team means you have your testers inside, your UA, if you have your UI, right? UA guys inside, the business analysts inside. Everything works in the backup anyhow defined and touches different heads. You have them inside in one team. That's the best approach because then you minimize head loss because they collaborating faster, way faster, right? Because they're usually sitting together, right? That's how I'm doing. Any other questions? Yes?
Maybe my question is very deep with the process. Can you show me the release, the branch?
The pipeline?
Yeah, the pipeline.
Sure.
Also, if there is any changes from the developers, they just merge directly to the main branch.
No. Yes. Okay. Yeah.
It means every developer should every time to pull the latest changes from the main branch. And if the case is there is a lot of conflicts from that side, then they need to resolve the conflicts every time. What if the resolving conflicts is taking times more than they develop the feature?
Okay, the other question is, what I give you back, as well as when you wait a week and then you merge it, isn't that it is more? So you may have more conflicts? So what you try is to aim, think about when you really have 200 lines of code, right? In one day, you develop in one day 200 lines of code. You merge them back, of course you have to pull first the latest changes, right? And merge them together. That's your responsibility as developer. But you have to either way, because otherwise you will break completely the mainland. And when you break the mainland, when your unit test goes red, I did mention it. When your unit test goes red, right, or test fails in the early stage, nobody ever has a more important job than fixing that. Because you will hold up other people's work. They will wait until it's fixed because they don't know in which state the current mainland is when it's not green, right? So it means either way, you have to mention it back and you will have conflicts. But but it does mean as well that any when, what they call it in the continuous delivery, right? When it's painful, do it more often because you get used to it, right? When you do merging only, I don't know, every week maybe in a big chunk, well, that's pretty painful. But try it in smaller chunks, because it's not that painful. You have less conflicts, I promise you that. And it's more easy.
Based on your experience, better to have the continuous delivery first? Or
yes,
set up
continuous delivery happens here, right? But the continuous delivery can be a trigger for ongoing things. But the reintegration, right? The continuous integration is upfront, it's here. Right? This is just the main part, integrate things together, right? For your next software release.
Actually, to continue continuous integration,
yeah.
We have an application that probably regulated because we are insurance company. So usually we use the feature trade because we will wait until the some features regulation approve or something like that.
Yeah.
So based on your slide presentation, do you prefer have a feature toggle and we put the approval waiting to be approved the features on the main thread, or you still have a feature thread for
well, kind of this? Feature toggle is one thing you can use. It is definitely not the best way. The best way is to chunk things so small that you really have the possibility to merge them back once a day, right? To bring them to conversion once a day. This is the aim. So when you have that all the time, that you have to do a feature branch because the features are too big. It's a too big chunk. Try sit together with backward pruning, right? Sit together with people, try to chunk this down. When you develop data systems, you don't have to start with the whole system, right? With the whole database. Start with one table, one column, and then add more and more. It takes time. That's the thing. This big scope, right? The big scope. So, congratulations. All right, we're over. Good time.
Okay, thank you. Thomas.